Hey, it's Dan at Mixture Rich coming to you from my basement today. So what am I up to? Well, it's not going to be aviation related, I can tell you that, but it is going to be a cool project. It's not original in any sense because I went scouring on the internet to find a solution to an interesting problem. So I have a fantastic turntable that I bought last year. Love it. It sounds fantastic, but there's always ways to improve things. So what I was discovering is that you can place a nice base under a turntable so that you can absorb a vibration and decouple it from the surface upon which the turntable is sitting on. And you can accomplish that either to one of two ways. You can purchase something online and you can get anything varying from $100 upwards of $2,000 and $3,000 when they've got these complicated schemes of concrete and lead shot and or granite and all sorts of interesting ways to create some mass underneath the turntable. But this one posting I found and some experimentation that's been done by some internet users is to find an inexpensive hardwood board or even a couple of them and put them together, create a decoupling mechanism and some anti-vibration and do it inexpensive and bespoke and at the same time have a fun project to do. So I'll show you what I'm about to do. So before getting underway, obviously we need some parts to do this, and these are things that are readily available. The first thing is the wooden blocks themselves, which are in fact a butcher block, cutting blocks made out of bamboo that came from Ikea. They're the Aptitlig, they're 17 and 3/4 by 14 and 1/4 inch, and they're about that thick, maybe about an inch and a half, and they weigh about 7.5 to 8 pounds each, and I have two of those. Followed by some adjustable feet like this that you can find quite easily on Amazon. I'll provide a link in the description below. That was about $20 for a package of four. And I bought a bag of 7/16 inch ball bearings, which you'll see in the next steps why this is necessary for the project. So all in all, 2 × 16, 32, plus $20 for the feet, that's 52, and $10 for the ball bearings, that's $62 Canadian pre-tax. Not too bad, and quite inexpensive to make a bespoke turntable base, which is going to turn out to be quite interesting. Okay, for the purposes of demonstration, I've attached the feet underneath. Well, in fact, I haven't actually attached them quite yet. This is just a test. And I will probably wait till I've stained these boards before I actually do that on a permanent basis. But as you can see, they're located as you go out towards the four corners. And I've used those little pads that come with those adjustable feet. Those lie on the surface flat. And then the foot itself, as you can see, has a little rotary knob on it. And you can adjust the height so that you can, of course, perfectly level this out. But you get the idea. This is now set up as a base platform. Now, coming to the top, this is where the grooves come in handy. So we're going to take ball bearings, four of them, and we're going to set them into the grooves, and I'll show you what comes next. So despite my little baggie coming with a whole ton of ball bearings, I only need four. And it becomes quickly apparent as to why four will work quite easily, because the way they'll be placed geometrically into the grooves will prevent the other board from moving around. So what we want to do is set up these ball bearings into these corners like that. They can be a little bit more spaced out like that and like that. Followed by which we want to take the other board and place it on top. So the other board is sitting with the opposing groove interconnected with those ball bearings. It creates a little gap between the two boards, as you can see. And what's interesting in the way that they're placed in those opposing corners is that now this platform doesn't move backwards, forwards, or side to side, but it does have a little bit of play, a little bit of wiggle in there, but it is stable. What I mean to say by this is that this top board will not come out left, right, back, or front, but it does have some play. So what we have achieved here is several things. We have the feet underneath, which decouple from the surface. We have the ball bearings, which are separating these two mass plates from each other so that there can be an absorption of the mechanical energy that's either coming in from the surface below as you're playing music and vibrations from those musics are moving the cabinet below your turntable. This will be absorbed
both by the mass dampening of the weight of these boards and also by this mechanical energy that will be absorbed by the ball bearings through the two plates. So, and a little added bonus, which I learned about in the article that I read, is that the turntable itself is in movement and it produces its own mechanical energy that has to get dissipated by having it on this surface and on top of those ball bearings. There's going to be some absorption of that mechanical energy through the boards. So we're decoupling away from the sound waves and vibrations that are in the room and from the turntable's self-induced vibrations. And that's basically it. That is the board. Next up, I'm going to be going ahead and staining and varnishing this thing, which are all steps you don't need to see.
And a quick snap of my fingers and it's stained and ready to go. So it's time to go try it out with the turntable.
So I've set down my bottom plate with a level to make sure that it's level back to front and side to side. And since my cabinet dips a little bit on the front, I've had to raise the feet, which you can probably see here as compared to all the way in the back. And if we look up at my level, front to back, sorry for the shadow, it's nice and level back to front. And we'll go side to side, and it's nice and level there as well. Next step will be installing the top plate. So I have my record player now set upon the base, and we're going to do a little test. Of course, this is an approximation, and it doesn't reflect an exact reality of how sound waves would interact with this surface down here. This my record player was set upon these cabinets directly on top, and the surface here was glass. And of course, any impact from sound would be hitting these doors and be resonating through this cabinet and up through to the turntable. Now, of course, the turntable had its own set of, I'm not sure what these are made of, but let's call them rubber feet underneath to make some isolation. But by adding this new isolation base, we should be eliminating a lot of the sound, that's sound waves that are traveling back up through the plinth and then, of course, into the record needle. So I've got the record turned off. I mean, it's not spinning, but the amplifier is on and I've got the needle set down on the record. So we can do a little bit of approximation. So this turntable used to be sitting down at this level, which is about the equivalent of sitting down over here. Now I've got the volume on my amplifier turned up so that we can hopefully hear this in the video. So if I tap here, we should hear the transmission of sound between this surface up into the record player plinth and then up through the needle and into the amplifier. Just for comparison, I'm going to do it directly on the plinth. And we can hear the difference. I mean, obviously, the feet on the record player itself do take up quite a bit of the vibration. So once again, over here. I find that pretty impressive. There's a noticeable difference between what is transmitted up now from the surface of this cabinet up through this isolation base and up into the record player. And that should translate very well in terms of sound quality. And as I mentioned earlier on, there's also the absorption of the mechanical energy of the record player itself, which, because it's sitting on this floating base, should help as well. So on to listening to some music now and see how this sounds acoustically. All right, so this is trusty. Tears for Fears, The Working Hour, and this has a nice bass and thump coming here. I'm going to raise the volume up, and basically you're going to have to trust me on this one, but I'm going to place my hand on the cabinet below and then touching the various surfaces to see how much vibration I feel coming back from the speakers themselves. So here we go. That's actually rather extraordinary, and you're going to have to take my word for it on this. But when I placed my hand down on the lower cabinet, the response back to my hand is quite significant. It's like a kick drum, and you can feel it quite distinctly. As I move up through the isolation base from the bottom plate to the top plate, and then finally to the plinth of the record player itself, it's just diminishing and diminishing to the point where when I'm touching the surface of the record player, I'm not getting any vibration whatsoever. And anyway, not in any detectable sense. As far as I'm concerned, that's mission accomplished, and I can hear just how crisp and clean, and I don't hear this this feedback that's coming back from the sort of that instantaneous delay of a thump that's produced by the speakers and coming back, and then of course being picked up by the needle. It just sounds so much cleaner than before. So I would say mission accomplished, and I would encourage you quite highly to make yourself a bass. And if you don't make yourself a bass, then definitely go out and get yourself one. I think that's pretty impressive.